this morning, we want to look at how the Holy Spirit has given us certain keys that can give us the victory in this Christian life, in this Christian walk. For a long time, we have been flogged by the enemy. We have been beaten up. We have been going through a lot of challenges, and the enemy has been winning to a large extent in our lives. But we believe in the name of Jesus Christ, we can have the victory. Amen? Because what Christ did on Calvary was to purchase that victory for us. And if he did our work, then we're supposed to be living in the victory that he has set up for us to live in. So when we are not living in that victory, then something is wrong. So we need to correct that. Amen? Amen? So we want to look this morning at three keys. And we're looking at position, power, and practice. What are those three? Position, power, and practice. So this morning we want to look at, see, what's our position in Christ? What's the power? Do we have a power to actually overcome the enemy? And I think we do. And we're going to look at some practice, some Christian disciplines that we ought to practice daily that can help us to live in this victory. Amen? Amen? Let's dive into the Word of God. So we're looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. Amen. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, if any man be where? If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things are become. So he says, if any man is positioned somewhere, where's that position? So if any man be in Christ, he is what? A new creature, a new creation. All things are passed away. When someone in your family died, you say they would have passed away, not so? So what he's saying is that all things are dead. And behold, all things are now new. So he says, any man that is in Christ, not just a select type of people who are in Christ. He says, any man. So whether you're an African man, an Indian man, a Chinese man, a Caucasian man, a Dogla man, whatever, once you're a man in Christ or a female man, whatever you are. He said, any man that is in Christ is a new creature, a new creation. All things are what? Dead. All things are passed away, and behold, all things are? All things are? My God. The problem that exists, brothers and sisters, is that for many of us, we don't understand the extent to which this new identity in Christ got to be alive. We don't understand this identity that we have. I'm reminded of a long-time story tale. You all remember the story of the ugly duckling? He was born in the wrong place. So for all intents and purposes, this egg was put, I don't know how it ended up there, but it ended up among the ducks in a farmyard. And when he was hatched, he came out looking a little different from his brothers and sisters. At least so he thought was brothers and sisters. So he was different. He was bigger. And from their perspective, he was ugly. And I think in nowadays time, he was so ugly, they would have said he ugly. So that they found that this duckling did not look like them. And because he did not look like them, he was criticized. Everybody find that he looking different from we. And in fact, the other farm animals say, but wait now, how are you so out of timing? The other farm animals looking at him and find him not like his brothers, he not like his sisters, he not like anybody else, he doesn't fit in. I wonder if you get what I'm saying. He doesn't fit into the normal status quo. He doesn't fit in to what everybody expected. He doesn't fit in to look like how everybody else look. So everybody wearing their lowriders, and he have his pants up on his waist. I don't know if you understand what I mean. Or if it was a she-duckling, everybody going out with their bra top and their pom-pom shorts and they're swinging whatever God give them. And she dressed decent and walking very elegant. and stepping and going to church. But they say she ugly. They don't like her. What is that? She's tush. So there's a little ugly duckling in the wrong place. But then you see what happens over a period of time. This duckling was finding nowhere I go. I think the story said that he left there and went to some other place. A man had him in some other place, and he went to the next farm. And everywhere he go, he find that he was not fitting in. I wonder if you get what I'm saying to you. But then one day he went down on a lake. And he saw some others that looked like him. We could probably call it church. That there was some type of, I'm seeing people that I could relate to now. There's something on the inside of me that is saying that I can connect with this person. And if it is that he was a single duckling, and he see a nice female single duckling, he say, hey, I like you. Because this one not like the ducklings on the farm. And what happened here is this. They started to tell this duckling, I like you. And when they started to introduce themselves, he started to see himself. So when he looked into the reflection, he realized, hey, this what I thought I was, I am not. So he now get a picture of his true identity. He now get a picture of something that is in him that he did not know before. He's now realizing that which I thought I was, I am not. And that which I did not know I am, that is what I am. So he's now seeing his real identity. And because he recognized who he is, can I say in Christ? His position changed. He now started to see himself as he ought to see himself. And he was able to spread his wings now and fly. And you know what happened? Other people started to see who this duckling really is. Because he was not no ugly duckling. He was a beautiful swan. And you see, what happens is this, brothers and sisters, people judge us based on their level. So people will see us based on who they are. You see, when you don't understand who you are, you will borrow the identity that somebody else tried to place on you. When you don't understand who you are, you will take what people are saying of you and not live up to what God is saying of you, who he created you to be. So people say you're ugly. People say you're this. People say you're good for nothing. People say you're that. And you accept that. Not understanding that you are more than just that. Not understanding that God has placed in you something that is totally different from what people say you are. They say you're just like your father. He was a drunkard, and you're going to be a drunkard too. You're just like your mother. She was at this, and you're going to be just like that too. And what we are recognizing, brothers and sisters, is if you understand who you are in Christ, you change your image. You see, the position that Christ has you in is totally different from man's opinion of you. And it's important for us, brothers and sisters, to recognize that I am positioned in Christ. And when I understand that identity that I have in Christ, that changes me. It breaks me free from the bondage of this world. And all the things that the enemy is saying in my life that says that I cannot do this and I cannot do that. I bound to get involved in this. I bound to get involved in sin. I bound to sell my body. I have no money, so what you expect me to do? How you expect me to get money? And we keep these kind of mentalities, these kind of things in our mind. And God is saying, no. You got to do something different. You're positioned in Christ. Tell your neighbor, I'm positioned in Christ. You see, the first step to victory, brothers and sisters, is identifying who you are. Getting that personal identity. When that duckling recognized that for truth he was not a duckling, he got delivered. Can I say this? And this might blow your Pentecostal bubble, but nobody lay hands on that duckling. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. He started to fly because he recognized who he was. And we're going to start to fly when we recognize who we are in Christ Jesus. You see, what has happened, brothers and sisters, is that we have been so schooled to think that I must have somebody do this to me in order for me to move on. I must have somebody do this to me in order for I to break free. We got to come out of that mentality and understand who we are in Christ Jesus. Let me tell you something. We are more than conquerors. You are more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus. Tell your neighbor, I'm more than a conqueror. Nana, say that like you really mean it, man. Nana, say that you're like you really, 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 really mean it. So I am more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus. Say, I am positioned. I am positioned. You see, what God has done, brothers and sisters, is he has allowed the Holy Spirit to come into our lives to tell us how we are positioned. Turn with me to Romans chapter 8, verse 15. What does it say? Read it for me, please. You have not received the spirit of bondage to fear. But what? You have received the spirit of what? Adoption. You have received the spirit of adoption that allows you to cry what? Abba Father. That word is daddy. So it's telling me that I have a heavenly Father. Amen? Look at the next verse. Verse 16. The spirit itself bears witness. So the Spirit of God bears witness with your spirit about your position in Christ. And what's your position in Christ? It's one of sonship. And we have to understand that when God sent his son, Jesus Christ, as his only son, he died so that we can have life. And when the Holy Spirit came now to give birth to the church, the Holy Spirit also came to identify those who are in Christ. So he came to identify you. And what he has done is that he has not just spoken it from the outside, but there is an inner witness that says to you that you are a child of God. There's an inner witness that says to you that you have been positioned in Christ as a son of God. That's powerful, isn't it? So that you are now positioned, not just as a servant, but as a son. And there are some female sons too, eh? And not the way that this world talking about it, eh? Be careful. So that our position is now one of sonship. Say sonship. That we come in a relationship with God, whereby we belong to him, that we are his and he is ours. And that's powerful. When you understand that relationship, when you understand that position, you recognize that you now flow at a different level of authority. Because if I am a child of God, then no devil in hell could come and do or undo what God has already done. I don't know if you get what I'm saying. No devil in hell could undo what God did in my life. He could try his best, but he can't do it. God says, I am the apple of his eye. You know what that means, you being the apple of his eye? Somebody say spoiled child. It simply means that you are in the focus. You are in God's focus. You see, when you look at somebody in the eye, and you're seeing beyond the white, you see the darker color, and then you see an next inner darker color. You all know that?
Yes.
Well, some people have wronger eyes, right? Yeah, good. Excellent. Has she? So you recognize that there is something on the inside. And when you look good, you realize if you really stare into that little spot there, you see you. So when we talk about God, that we be in the apple of his eye, that means that you are in his focus in such a way that if you can only get a glance into God's eye, you're going to see your own reflection. He cares so much about you. He focuses on you. Because you are his child. And that's a privilege. It is not something that every single person in the world can claim. And I know that there is a popular belief that all of us are God's children. In fact, we say it like this. All are we as God's children. And do you know that's not the truth? The word of God declares in that same Romans chapter 8, he says, as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. So what we are saying, brothers and sisters, is that the Spirit of God leads us into that place of sonship. And as we go on today, brothers and sisters, God willing, we're going to get a clearer understanding as to what that means. In fact, let's dive into it one time. There are three elements of sanctification that the Holy Spirit does. And this is a little theological, but we're going to keep it at a level that we can all understand it. Is that okay? But there are three levels that the Holy Spirit works on us in terms of bringing us into that right place with God. One is justification. Say justification. And justification is whereby we who were sinners, God decided that because of the work of Christ, and we accepting the work of Christ, we now become in alignment with God. So that our past life, our sins are now canceled off. Because we have now accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. And we now become what is referred to as justified. We now become in right standing with him. We are now forgiven of our sins. So we are justified. So even though we were sinners, because of the work of Christ on Calvary, not because of my own works, because I can recognize what Christ have done, I can now be counted as justified. And then there's the second element that is normally referred to as sanctification. Some people refer to it as progressive sanctification. This is an ongoing work of the Holy Spirit on the inside of a believer. And we're going to be spending a lot of time on that aspect because that's where we got to work. Amen?
Amen?
And then the third element of our sanctification is glorification. And what is glorification? It speaks about when Christ appears, we too shall appear with him. It talks about us being taken up, us being able to enter into the glories of God. That's the work that God is about to do in our lives. The first element of justification cancels off now the consequences of our sin. Because we were sinners, justification cancels off the consequence. The progressive, that sanctification work, that's that part that brings us into spiritual maturity. That helps us now. You know, when we talk about growing in faith, it's about living this life as a mature believer. And that's where we want to be focused on today. Spiritual maturity. It brings forth freedom from the power of sin. You got that? You didn't get that? We didn't get that yet. And I'll tell you why you didn't get that. Because for some of us, brothers and sisters, we don't believe that's possible. But we're going to show you how it's possible. Amen? And glorification is going to be saved from the presence of sin. Once we are in this earth, we are going to be in the presence of sin. Do you know that? If we say that we have no sin, we lie. And we make God a liar. So that we're going to always, once we are walking on this face of this earth, we're going to have that presence of sin. But when we are glorified, when we are taken up, when we are no longer part of this earth, you're going to realize that we are no longer subjected to the presence of sin. Because then where God is, we are going to be. I wonder if you got that. And where he is, no sin can dwell in his presence. So we're going to be glorified. We're going to have that glorified body. But where we want to focus this morning, brothers and sisters, is that second element, that middle element, which is that progressive perspective of sanctification, that is spiritual maturity. Coming to a place of spiritual maturity, coming from the bondage to the world to be able to live in the liberty whereby Christ hath made us free. And this is why Christ have actually brought our salvation, so that we can indeed have that freedom in our lives. So we want to look at the power. Say power. Power. We want to look at the power at work in me. Hallelujah. So we recognize that there's a power. In Acts chapter 1 verse 8. Acts chapter 1 verse 8. We looked at it a couple of weeks ago. And he said that you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. You shall receive what? You shall receive what? He says, but you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be a what? Witnesses. And last day we spent some time looking at that. And we said that the empowerment that we receive is to help us to become a what? A witness. And did we stop at just the term witness, or did we qualify the term witness? You can't remember. We said that you will become an effective witness for Christ. And what we said is that our life is supposed to reflect who Christ has called us to be. So when we talk about this power, there is something at work on the inside of us. There is something that God wants to do with us. In fact, if you turn with me in your Bible to Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20. What does it say? Now unto him that is able to do what? My God. Exceeding abundantly above all that we can ask or think, according to what? According to? Say it one more time. According to the what? Power that is at work in whom? So that there is a power at work in you. And God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that you can ask or think, based on what? The power that is at work in you. So what I'm recognizing is that there's a power. Say power. Power. And when we talk about power, we ain't talking about just catching the power. We are talking about a power at work. Anywhere you have electricity is as a result of some power that has flowed through. Not so, Mr. Electrician? Somewhere it's connected. Look at the next slide there. Anybody knows what is that? A power plant, a power station. And I'm thinking of this. When I read that scripture, there's a power at work in me. I'm understanding how this operates. And I don't know all the details of electrical engineering and all these mechanical engineering. I haven't studied that. But I guess something happens. There's some type of input, there's a process, and there's an output. Can we summarize it in that way? So possibly natural gas goes in, it is processed in some way, it fuels something happening, a boiler kind of reaction takes place, steam goes up, turns a turbine, electricity is generated, and it sends it out, correct? Something like that? All right, good. So we get endorsement there. Something like that. So that there's this generation of electricity that takes place, and then there's what we refer to as distribution. And this distribution now goes all over the country. And it affects households. Correct? It affects members of our society. It affects it in such a way that if a man climbs up the pole and he does not have the right PPE, personal protective equipment, he can get electrocuted and he can die. You know why? Because of the amount of power that releases from that. It is so dynamic. It is so, in fact, it's kind of engaging. Because if you go there and you don't have the, if I'm not mistaken, it kind of pulls you into it. Not so? It does. So there's a kind of magnetic force. It's engaging. And what I'm recognizing, brothers and sisters, is the Holy Spirit works on the inside of us kind of like that. In that he takes that which is of Christ. There's a power at work on the inside of us, possibly like that power station. And he takes that which is of Christ. Probably the fuel, the LNG or whatever fuel that comes from Christ. And he places it in our hearts. And he processes that. And then there's a release. There's an outflow that takes place. I wonder if you get what I'm saying. So that when we go now and we talk about this life in Christ Jesus, this distribution affects our entire body. So it touches our mind. It touches our hand. It touches our legs. It touches, guess what, your groin too. Your private parts. Yes. So that you now know that this power that is at work in you affects your members. It affects you. And so much so, brothers and sisters, that when the power is at work and you connect with someone else, healing could flow. When the power is at work and you connect with someone else, the Spirit of God can... can shock you. In fact, so much so that when the power of God is at work, you who used to be a cussbud, you who used to be a drunkard, you who used to be a womanizer, you who used to be a manizer, you who used to be whatever you come from, your life becomes so transformed, people get shocked when they see you. People get shocked. They say, but wait now, that is Brother Kent? That is Rasta? Look, Ras. And he was a Rasta? Wait. He was a Rasta up there yesterday? I wonder if people shock. What about the man who used to thief? I have a fella in here. Shh, I wouldn't call him. The man was a bandit, you know. The man pulled off a gas station robbery, you know. And God touched that man's life and transformed him. You understand what I'm saying to you? There are people in here who you're going to be shocked to know where they come from and what they used to do. You understand why? Because there is a power at work in them. And that processing is still taking place. That it's taken, the Spirit of God is taking that which is from Christ Jesus. The grace of God that is from Christ Jesus. The mercies of God. He's taking the redemptive work of Christ and processing it on the inside of you. So that there can be an output that could give light to this world. Jesus says, I send you out as light in the darkness. The problem with the church is that many of us refuse to shine. And because we refuse to shine, the power is cut off. Because the Lord is not wasting his resources. That's a heavy statement, isn't it? It is true. Because when we start to do things for God, you're going to recognize the power is going to be flowing. When you stop doing things for God, guess what? It's going to be withheld. It's not that God is just deciding, hey, you see you, I don't want. It's we who refuse. We are the ones who want to cut off the power. Turn with me to John chapter 3, verse 16, 17, and 18. For God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Jesus didn't come into the world to bring condemnation, amen? But that the world through him might be. Let's go on. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that light is come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light. Why? Because they shut it off. There are lots of men who like darkness rather than light. Why? Because their deeds are evil. So God is not going to be shining light in places that he doesn't want, that we don't want light to shine. Go ahead, next verse. For everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither come to the light, lest his deeds be reproved. But he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds may be made manifest that they are wrought in God. So what we are saying, brothers and sisters, is that if we are in truth, we're going to like the light. Why? Because the things that we are doing is what God has wrought in us to do. There's a work that is on the inside happening, brothers and sisters, and God is producing. He's a producer, and he's causing us to do things after him. So he's allowing the Holy Spirit to work in us to become better. Say better. So that when we see this whole aspect about light shining in the darkness, we got to be that light shining. We got to be different. So that we don't want to be, I don't want to be connected to a power source and not shining. You have how much volts of electricity running through you. And all you need to do is to allow the gospel to be heard. Allow the grace of God to be heard in you. And all we need to do is open our mouth and say, Jesus is Lord. We need to allow the light of God to shine through our lives. And then we're going to see now how this power energizes us. It does what? To live different. What Christ is doing in us, brothers and sisters, is bringing us to the realization. Let's go back to Romans 8. Bringing us to a realization that there is something at work in us. Romans 8, 10. Back to Romans 8. And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin. So he says here, if Christ be in you, what happens? The body is dead because of sin. Look at the next verse. Read it one more time. If the spirit of him that raised Jesus from the dead dwell in you, where does the spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwell in? It dwell where? In you. Does it?
Yes.
You sure?
Yes.
Sometimes somebody say, this is not an off and on thing, you know. I know we're talking about electricity, but this off and on switch thing, we're not into that, you know. He says here, but if. So it's conditional. There's an if here. So it's presupposing that this is not the case for every single person. But he says, if the spirit of him that raised Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his spirit that dwells in you. So what he's saying is this, that there is a work that is going on the inside of you if you have the Spirit of Christ resident on the inside of you. The same one who raised Christ from the dead is going to cause this mortal body to come alive by that same Spirit that is working on the inside of you. So there are spiritual turbines working on the inside of you to cause this body to come alive. To cause this flesh to become alive unto God. That's what it's about. So when you look at this, you recognize that there's something working. If the Spirit of God is at work on the inside of you, there's something happening on the inside of you to bring you in alignment with God. Because the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead is at work on the inside of you. And if he can do that for Christ, whose body was dead, you who are alive to this world but dead to God can now come alive to God. This work is not just our own, but we have a responsibility. And part of our responsibility is to submit to the work that the Spirit of God is doing on the inside of us. A lot of us don't want to submit because we hear what God is saying, we hear what God is doing, but we deafen our ears and we say, Lord, I ain't ready for that yet. And there are plenty of people who say, I ain't ready to change. I ain't ready for my life to be different. I ain't ready to go through this thing. And we say, all these prayers, I can really can't handle that. Why they bring me in church here this morning? But there is something that's going to go to work. And that is going to bring a transformation in you, brothers and sisters. It happened to me on September 12th, 1993. I gave my life to Christ Jesus. And the Spirit of God started to work in me. A different type of work. I was dead in trespasses and sin. But God brought me alive by his grace. And by the work of the Holy Spirit on the inside of me. This whole process that we have now, brothers and sisters, is for us now to start doing that work, what God has called us to do. We have to submit to him. We have to come to that place of realizing that he alone is God. And besides him, there is no other. That work has to go on. And he's working right now in each one of us. Now, we want to continue looking at this power now, but from a different angle. We're still in Romans chapter 8. Let's go back up to verse 2. Because when we talk about power, we speak about the power that comes through from electricity. But there is another type of power at work that we call governmental power. Look what it says here. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. Laws are given by authority structures. The people who are in charge makes the laws. So in our country, we have a parliament that makes the laws. Not so? Why? Because they are in charge. Next year, we're going to have general elections, and you'll have the opportunity to elect a government who you believe is going to make the best laws for our society, correct? And who's going to manage our country in the best way. So that there's governmental authorities that place down laws. And whatsoever authority we submit to their laws. We submit to their principles. We submit to their governance. And if we submit ourselves to the enemy, we submit to his laws, his principles, and his governance. All of us would have been there at some point in time. I was there. And if you are honest with yourself, you would say that you were there as well. Because all of us were once trapped in trespasses and sin. And don't watch me with that holy look. Everybody has sinned and come short of the glory of God. All have sinned. And anytime we say, isolate ourselves and say, well, you see you, me, I never sin. You lie. In fact, that was a sin. You understand? But all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So all of us would have been under that law at one point in time. But what the word of God says here is that the law of the spirit of life in Christ hath made us free from that law that we were under before. So that even though we were under that law of sin and death, we are now freed from that. Why? Because there's a new law at work in me. And what's that new law? This law of the spirit of life, which is where? In Christ Jesus. So it simply means that when I live in Christ, when I find myself in that position in Christ, I am now under a new law. And this law is not even written on paper. It's not written on tablets in stone. This new law is not even written. You know, God gave Moses 10 commandments and he inscribed it on stone. This new law is not written even there. The word of God declares this new law is inscribed in our hearts. It's here on the inside of us. It's etched on the inside of us so that now we can now live based on that law that is on the inside. And it's not self-determinant. Eh? It's not that which you think about for yourself. It's the Holy Spirit now inscribes it on your heart that says to you that this is how you ought to live and this is the type of life that you ought to live, because what is happening is that he wants you to come in alignment with God. So he knows exactly how to bring you in alignment with God. And if you could read, whether you can, whether you could see, whatever you are, whatever position you find yourself in, God's Holy Spirit can minister to you about what God wants you to do and what it means to please God. You see, all through our lives, we have been listening to what people say as to how to please God. But what he's saying now is that he's going to bring it in such a way that nobody will have to teach you how to please God, but you shall know for yourself. And this is where the Holy Spirit comes to work. Remember we talk about that churning on the inside? He's working with you so that you can understand what it does, what it means to please God. All our lives we have been trying to do something and we have not been able to do it. Why? Because we have not connected to the only true source of knowing how to please God. Check yourself. You try to do it all out. In your own strength, in your own effort. And we can't do it. No matter how, the children of Israel, they received, God spoke with Moses face to face. He gave him the 10 commandments. While God was doing that, the children of Israel was down on the hill making a golden calf and calling the golden calf Jehovah. Come on. I wonder if you get what I'm saying. When we try to do it for ourselves, that's what we do. We erect idols. But when the Holy Spirit works on the inside, he starts inscribing in our hearts. And he tells you, and he tells you, and he tells you, don't do that. Do this. Don't go there. Go here. Don't listen to that. Listen to this. Turn off of that. Remember what we said the last day? The word of God tells us, try every spirit. Not everything you hear called Christian is Christian.
That's right.
Come on. Not everybody who say they are pastor is a pastor. Not everybody who says a prophet is a prophet. Some of them prophet. You understand? Yeah. And not every, some prophet lie, not everybody prophesy. You understand? And church, can I tell you this? Can I warn you about something? Is it okay here? Not because somebody could call your name and tell you what is your phone number and what car you drive. That doesn't mean that the gift of prophecy is in operation. I wonder if you hear what I'm saying. That does not define the gift of prophecy. It doesn't. It's closer to the word of knowledge, but still it doesn't even define the word of knowledge. But sometimes we see and we hear it on television and we see it on the internet, and probably about 90% of those churches in Africa that you see coming off, you're seeing these things that are calling people out and they're telling them, and somebody say, oh, look, God captured somebody on the iPad. You all saw that one? Stupid one. You all didn't see that? A man in South Africa. He called somebody out and he said, I can't pronounce your wife's name. I can't pronounce your wife's name. Come, lend me your iPad. And when he took the iPad, he pressed something there and, oh, the Lord captured. Who is this? And he said, that's my wife. That's my wife. And the whole church, about 15,000 people, going in uproar saying that God captured the man thing on the iPad. And next one talking on the phone and saying, is this heaven? 15,000, 10,000 people who are supposed to be Christians sit down in a church and clapping and saying, God talking to this man on a telephone. And these are things that are passing for prophecy and the gift of prophecy in our nations of the world today. And the church is accepting it. Why? Because that engine is not working on the inside. Because the Spirit of God is not working on the inside. How in the world are we going to see these things and we're going to accept it as truth? You can call 1-800-PSYCHIC now and they will call every single thing. What color your eyes is, what color your hair is, what you're wearing as your shoes, what color. They can do that now. Why? Because the Spirit of divination can do that. Spirit of divination can do that. And I am afraid for the church of this era because we have accepted the spirit of divination to be at work in the church and there is no consciousness as it pertains to this is not of God. We have to be careful. We have to be careful, church. The Lord warns us in the last day, don't move after itching ears. Don't cause your ears to itch you to say, I want to hear this and I want to hear that and I want to hear that. What you need to hear is the truth. You understand? And this is why the Holy Spirit is given as the Spirit of truth to teach us all truth and to bring us into all truth and to cause us to remember what Christ has said. So what God is doing, he's allowing a new law to work on the inside. And the law of the Spirit is at work. So we can be submitted to what the Spirit is doing so that we can have direction of the Spirit of God. Don't take every and anybody's direction. I tell from the time we established this church to now, I have kept saying it. If you hear me, if something go wrong and I get mad and I start to preach things that are contrary and I telling you to do things that are contrary, you get up and go. Don't stay and accept that. If I start to tell you and say, okay, well, when we have communion, lock all the doors, and we pulling out something out of a black bottle and you know, like what? Jim Jones and David Koresh and those kind of things like that. I tell you to go and strap metal on your body and go on for the cause of Christ's sake. Don't listen to me. This pastor gone mad. I wonder if you get what I'm saying to you. Don't come and say, okay, well, you know, once the Lord, this prophet say this, if you know it's error, get out. I wonder if you understand what I'm saying. This is not just minor doctrinal differences or whatever. This is life. There are certain things that are called a salvific. There are certain things that are going to affect your salvation. And we have to ensure that when we stand knowing that whatsoever we're doing, it does not hinder us from the glory that is to come. We have to stand. And what the Holy Spirit is doing is that he is allowing us to know from the inside what he is saying. And when we speak, any prophet, any evangelist, any pastor, any apostle who should speak, any teacher who should speak, your test is the word of God. You've got to line up what is being spoken to the word of God. And if it does not align with the word of God, brothers and sisters, we can wholeheartedly reject it. The authority of a prophet is the word of God. All through the ages, from the time that you had Abraham coming straight down, what was the most distinguishing mark of a prophet is that they spoke the word of God. Not all of them spoke things that were supposed to come to pass, but all of them spoke things that God had said to speak. And it's important for us to understand that. There are some prophets who are going to just stand and declare, this is what God has said from his word. And that can be an authentic prophet, even though he may not say the things that are to come. And there are some who's going to say things that are to come, and they do not speak from God's word, and it's not a prophet. We have to understand that the only authenticating tool that we have is the word of God. And anything that we do in the spirit realm has to come in alignment with the word of God. This whole thing about just holding on to what the spirit says, and the spirit has to come in alignment with God's word. That's why we call him the spirit of truth. And the word of God declares that when he comes, he's going to speak the things that I have said. So we are not just holding on to some kind of super spiritual, some kind of spooky thing. We are holding on to the word of God. And the spirit of God that works on the inside inscribes on us this new law that we got to live by. Don't be deceived. Don't allow yourself to fall under deception. Amen? So the spirit works. So that's the power at work on the inside of us. When you are living your life, you have to understand this, that God is working a power on the inside of you. There's a power at work. So this whole aspect of your life being in alignment with God has to come from his word. So the things that we do, hear me? The things that we do must be based on the authority of God's word. Because we're going to look now, in the few minutes that we have, to see that there are things that we got to do. There are things we got to practice. Because we talk about this power at work. But it empowers us to do something. That bulb receives power to shine. Correct? So that the energy that comes from the power station is to act. You didn't get that? So what can we do? Turn with me to Galatians chapter 5, verse 16. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not do what? So we are saved, we are sanctified, we have been made holy, we have been set apart, but we still struggle with the flesh. There's a warring that takes place on the inside of us, not so? There are these two laws that we spoke about, the law of the spirit of life and this law of sin and death. And there's a struggle that is taking place on the inside of us. That the things that we want to do, we find ourselves not being able to do it. And the things that we don't want to do, that's what we find ourselves doing. Paul said that there is a warring on the inside. And here he's saying now, he's given us a solution how we can overcome that war. How we can win the war. And it seems very simple enough, but yet we find it so difficult. He says here, walk in the Spirit. Do what?
Walk in the Spirit.
So then, if it sounds so simple, why can't we walk in the Spirit? Because for many of us, the lust of the flesh continues to overwhelm us. And for some, when we think about the lust of the flesh, we only think about it from a sexual perspective. But it goes beyond just that. It includes that. But it goes beyond just that. You see, in fact, if you read on, I like the scripture to speak, you know. Because when you read on, you're going to see the works of the flesh. Verse 17.
Spirit.
So now he says that, right? So he says that there's this warring against the flesh, against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh. Do you all see that happening practically in your lives? Anybody? Or is just the preacher? Every day? Some people, yeah. So you find that there is a warring that takes place on the inside of you. Correct? That the fleshly man wants to actually have his way, and the spiritual man trying to get some sort of say. You understand? That's what he's saying there. Go ahead. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, sedition, heresies, envies, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such the like. You see that last one? What's the last one? Not reveling. It has one after reveling. And such the like. You see that one? That one is for the critical examiner of the word. What do I mean by that? There are some people who are very critical as they examine the word, and they will take every word, and then they will take this list that was given and say, okay, well, I ain't doing that. Or I don't know what is that. So what he said is that he qualifies another one, and he says, such the like. It means anything like that. You understand? So that critical examiner could be able to recognize that anything like this falls into the works of the flesh. So what he's saying here is this: if we walk in the spirit, we will not do these things. That's an ouch moment. Because somebody here going to see themselves in that passage. So you may not be in adultery, you may not be in fornication, but you may be drunkard. Or you may be reveling. You know what is reveling? Partying. A party all night. Only realize that I, at age 17, I get saved. Eh? So you realize that out there. What is that? What? Yes, you're correct. I learned that from Christopher. But you understand what I'm saying? So the reveling, the drunkenness, the party, the what else? What does it say here? Hatred. Oh my gosh. What about the hatred? What about the wrath? You know there are some people who they just angry and no matter. Eh? Lasciviousness is ungodly desires, that innate desire for, you're not into adultery, you're not into fornication, but you're sitting down all night watching pornography. That's an ouch moment, isn't it? What about witchcraft? You know what is witchcraft? Obia. Yeah? So you're going and your husband giving a little trouble, so you know somebody who could do a little simidimi and make sure he get a little left hand dumpling or stay home. Eh? Your money a little tight, so you're gone by somebody and they tell you what to do, and they give you a little potion to mix and or put something in your little wallet, or a little garlic in your wallet, or a little this and your, you know, witchcraft. You bury something in the yard. Your neighbor giving you trouble. Oh gosh, this is a familiar one. Neighbor giving you trouble. So you decide, hear this, you're going by Papa Doc, and you get a little something, nothing too big, and you put it right there in the corner. And all of a sudden you hear neighbor house burn down. Hey, it worked, boy. Witchcraft! So what we are saying, brothers and sisters, is these things are against the Spirit of God. And what we are saying is that many of us, we allow ourselves to be given to these things, and we have to resist them. We have to turn away from them. We have to walk away from it. Don't go down the path of the ungodly. So when we talk about walking in the Spirit, we have to make sure that we don't live our lives after these principles. Walking in the Spirit is allowing ourselves to adopt the principles of God in our daily life. That's what it's about. Allowing the Spirit of God to give direction to our lives. The Word gives direction to us. The Holy Spirit uses the Word. It touches our lives and causes action. You all remember what we said earlier on? God speaks. The Spirit moves, God speaks, and we respond. That's what's supposed to be happening. When we hear what God is saying in our lives, we got to respond. Don't live your life based on the principles of this world. Tell your neighbor, I done that. Tell your neighbor, and mean it. Say, I done that. You don't have to tell them what you done of, but tell them, I done that. Whatever it is, go through it. Tell your neighbor, I done that. Because what we have to do, brothers and sisters, is turn away from these things. The Word of God gives us direction. He says, if it is that we walk in the Spirit, we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. And many of us, brothers and sisters, the reason why we have all this trouble is because we continue to walk in the flesh rather than in the Spirit. We continue to allow our natural man and our natural desire to create within us that drive and that motivation. We are enticed to do things that are wrong. And let me tell you something. Wrong tastes nice. The reason why it's a temptation to us is because it's enticing. So not because it feels good, that doesn't mean we got to do it. I wonder if you get what I'm saying. Somebody say, if it feels good, do it. No, 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 no. That's the devil talking. You understand what I'm saying to us? Because many of us, we fall into that trap and feel that we got to just go by what feels good. And if it feels good, I'm going to do it. And because it feels good, I want that and I want this. And something look good. Oh, my gosh, look at this nice girl. Woo! Or whatever is your preference. Some people don't like that. You understand? Some people preference different. So you see, hey, baby, darling, I want you to be my main squeeze. And we go after that. Oh, nice, tall, dark, and handsome. Oh, again, according to your preference, short and dark and handsome. I ain't calling no names. You can call, I will whistle. Only if you understand what I'm saying. So you see, the Word of God declares this, yet all that is in the world, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. These three, they are not of God. So when you see things, what is lust of the eyes? You see something that you real like, your real desire, whatever you see, your eye get big, it starts to get cocky because of what you see. And you get excited. Lust of the flesh, you have a craving on the inside of you. There's something that you want bad, 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 bad. And then pride. When you accomplish certain things, you get certain self-actualization. The danger with sexual sin is this. It falls into all three categories. The lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and when you get a girl, you feel proud. Pride. That's the danger with sexual temptation. So what we have to do is recognize that we got to break free. So how do we break free? By changing our desire. Romans chapter 12 verse 2 says, be not conformed to this world, but be what? Transformed by the what? Renewing of your mind. So we have to start thinking differently. If we keep thinking the same way, we will keep doing the same things. And the Holy Spirit now comes on the inside and he generates new thoughts. You all remember what we said about that internal generation system? The Holy Spirit generates on the inside us new thoughts, thoughts that are going to align with God's word. So what we have to do now is study God's word so that we can come in alignment and give ourselves over to what God is saying in his word. Anytime we reject the word, we reject God. The Holy Spirit now brings those thoughts to remembrance. So when you study in God's word now, he brings this thought, I shall not look at a handmaiden and lust with lust in my eyes. Job said that. So you know definitely now that when you start to see things that you're not supposed to see and you're walking down the road and somebody sit on bad, you turn your head instead of look. All of you get what I'm saying? Ladies, a man stand up at the side of the road, he ain't looking, so you're turning so. Because you set now your eyes in alignment with what God's word has said. So that you're not going to defile your eyes. So you sit down now by the computer. Remember, I make a covenant with my eyes. On your phone. Remember, I make a covenant with my eyes. I will not look at a maiden and lust. And whether she's a maiden, a mother, whatever, you're not looking to lust. And ladies, help out the brothers now. When you come to church, for heaven's sake, for our sake, for the brother's sake, Help my brother out now. Poor brother, he make that covenant with his eyes. He will not look at a handmaiden and lost. And when he come into his, God help me. He watch down. Oh gosh, I can't watch there. He watch up. I can't watch there. He watch around. I can't watch there. Oh God. Say, God help our brother. Ladies are a little more, they're not as, well, some are, but they're not as visually stimulated as men. Right? Some are. Some ladies can't see our pants full past. Right? So we're walking in the spirit, right? Tell anybody we're walking in the spirit. So walking in the spirit now is coming in alignment with God, what God says, and allowing there to be daily disciplines. Say daily disciplines. Daily disciplines. So you see that when I talk about using the word of God? Now Jesus was tempted. Do you know that Jesus was tempted? In Matthew chapter 4 and Luke chapter 4, you see that Jesus was tempted. And what Jesus used in the midst of his temptation? What did he use? The word of God. He says, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds. And the three temptations that Jesus faced, he used the word of God to combat the temptations. That tells us something. If Jesus, who was the living word, was able to use the written word to fight against the enemy, then we who have the living word on the inside of us can use the written word to fight the enemy. I wonder if you get what I'm saying to us. So let us allow ourselves to be absorbed in God's word so that when the temptation comes, we're going to have the word of God already locked up in our hearts. The word of God says, thy word have I locked up in my heart that I shall not sin against you. So daily Bible study, Bible reading is important. One discipline that you need to have, get familiar with God's word. God's word is God speaking to us. So when you read God's word, you are listening to the voice of God speaking to you. And that is what helps to equip you now. Secondly, another practice, daily discipline to practice. One, Read God's word. And when I say read, you don't have to read a whole book today. You could read a little portion. There's two aspects of reading that we have. One is devotional reading, and one is knowledge-based reading, where you're reading to get knowledge, get information. It doesn't make sense that you read the whole Bible and you don't know one thing that was said there. So take it in what I refer to as digestible bits. You understand what I'm saying? So if you know that you could only read and understand a small portion, take your time. Eat little and live long. You understand? If it means that you read one chapter or one paragraph or one verse, read it. I'm not going to tell you read a whole chapter if you never read a verse before. Start a little portion. A little piece by piece. And every day you could probably increase. Or every month you increase. So if you read one verse this week, next week, try to read two verses. I wonder if you get what I'm saying. And encourage your children to read the word too. Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I will not sin against you. So read the word. In our Bible studies, in our community groups, we have been studying the word. And over the last 3 weeks, we have been looking at Psalms. And it has been so empowering. And we looked at it from a devotional perspective. When you read, if you read one verse, try to figure out, what does this verse say to me? What is it that God is saying through this verse? Try to understand. Ask the passage some questions. For example, John 3:16. Let's look at that. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. What stands out in that to me? God's love. What happens because of God's love? God loved the world so much. God loved who? The world. How much? Plenty. So much. And what he did as a result of his love? He gave. So I wonder if you get what I'm saying. If you read one verse, ask yourself, what is this saying? Find out what is the subject of this verb, who it is speaking, what is it that is being said, and how I can apply. So which means if I was in the world, God loved me, and he gave his only begotten son for me. So what I got to do? Believe in him. And if I believe in him, what will happen? I will not perish, but what? I will have everlasting life. That's a Bible study you just did in 10 minutes. And you tell me you don't have time to read God's word? You're so busy? If you're too busy to pray, you are too busy. God gave you life. If you can't spend 5 minutes, 10 minutes, you're too busy. Read God's word. Pray. Spend time in prayer. Let's pray. When you read the Bible, you just spend some time in prayer. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. You pray about what? God's love. God, I thank you for your love for me. I decide now that I want to believe in you. In fact, I believe in you. You can pray from God's word right there. I don't know if you get what I'm saying. Right there. You don't know what to pray for? Guess what? You just read a Bible and pray something from what you actually read there. Pray for yourself. Pray for your family. Pray for the church. Pray for your pastor. God knows your pastor needs prayer. Pray for his family. Pray. Pray for your friend. Pray for your neighbors. Pray for the people who don't like you. Pray for the people who you like you. Pray for the people who you like and don't like you. Pray for the people who you don't like and like you. Pray. There's so much things to pray for. You could pray. Ask God to bless them. Don't pray that fire go burn them. No. Pray that God is going to touch their life and that God is going to bring transformation in their life. Pray for your boss that he will give you a raise. Pray for your boss that they will behave themselves. Pray for your husband or your wife so that they will behave themselves. Pray. Every one of us, we can spend time. Pray for the power of the Holy Spirit to be manifested in your life. Pray for God's move in your life. Pray to help you to stop the bad habits, the smoking, the drinking. Pray, ask God. There are so much things. You telling me you don't know how to pray? Come on. All you need to do, pray, is communication with God. That's what it is. And you don't need a special invitation again. He already invited you. He said, come. Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. You burdensome. You have all kind of frustration, things going on that you don't know how to deal with it. All you need to do is go to God and say, Lord, help me. You don't know what to say? Say, Lord, help me. Peter was walking on the water, and he was going to Jesus, and he started to sink. He could not find any other word. All he could say is, Lord, save me. That might be your prayer. Because you know you're drawn in. You know you're in trespass. You know you're in sin. All you need to say is, Lord, save me. Invite the Holy Spirit. Lord, let your Holy Spirit come into my life. Read the Bible. Pray. From this evening, make every effort to start spending time with God. You have your family? Call your family together. Let's pray. Let's pray at least once a month even. Once a week. Come on. So let's pull together and pray. Tell your neighbor, let's pray. Let's pray. And finally, third point, practice daily to help overcome. Regular church attendance. What did I say? Let me tell you why that is important. Because when you're doing something wrong, you feel shame to come to church. That's it. Especially on a communion Sunday. Isn't that true? So you know if it is that you come into church regularly, you try to behave yourself regularly. So that when you come to church on communion, you could take communion with a clear heart. Not so? Church attendance is important. One of the things that helps us to overcome the world is our faith. He says, this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. In Romans chapter 10, he says that faith comes by hearing and hearing the word. So the delivery of the word being spoken actually helps to build your faith. You get teachings that can help you to move from the knowledge that you have to a higher level of knowledge. And guess what? When you don't have knowledge, the word of God says, my people perish for lack of knowledge. This information that you have here today, if you apply it to your life, if you take the knowledge that you have received, this knowledge about your position in Christ, this knowledge about your power that is being released, and these daily practices that you got, if you apply this knowledge, you're going to see yourself being able to overcome the temptations that the enemy has brought against you. I don't know if you get what I'm saying. There's more to this. But if you start by this, these simple steps, understanding who I am in Christ, understanding that there is power at work on the inside of me. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. If Jesus is on the inside of me and the devil is in the world and Jesus is greater than the enemy, why must I be submitted to the enemy and not submitted to Christ? Why is it that the enemy is winning in my life over Christ? Why? Because we don't have the knowledge and we are not submitted to that information. Some of us have the knowledge. So when you look at that, my people perish for lack of knowledge. The next part of that is because they have rejected knowledge. I will reject you. So you don't want to receive information that is going to change your life and reject it. I don't know if you get what I'm saying. These three disciplines can help you if you apply it daily as a practice. You pray, you spend quality time in God's word, and you spend quality time coming to church. Let your church attendance be a regular thing. This is an appointment with God. A lot of times people take this for granted. Somebody was reminding me I was at a function on Thursday, and a good friend of mine, Rickford, he had his anniversary service on Thursday, and I was there in the congregation, and he was reminding me that for our wedding, Renee and I, when we got married, the pastor indicated that that was the first day from the time that I accepted Christ to that day when I was getting married, was the first day I had missed church service. And technically, I didn't miss church because I was in church for that Sunday. part of my growth can be directly attributable to my submission and my continued attendance to the house of God. Because I receive teachings that help me to grow. We take this for granted so much, but we keep doctor's appointments. We keep our job appointments. Every Monday morning, no matter how tired we feel on a Sunday, we get up and we go to work. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, some people Saturday and Sunday they work too. But to take a little time out, to be consistent in church, we don't see that as a priority. For what reason? Because of the fact that there are other things. So if I have time, I will come to church. If I have nothing to do, I will come to church. If I don't have any other engagement, I will be there. And that's how it sounds. But we don't set things and say, okay, well, I cannot come because I have church at that time. I wonder if we get that. This is a set appointment. So if we can set this within our schedule, you will realize that this is a discipline. That's what it is, a daily discipline. The problem that we have for many of us is that we're not disciplined. The reason why we can't get up and pray is because we're not disciplined. Why we can't spend time in the Bible? Because we're not disciplined. Everything else distracts us, so we can't focus. And that's the challenge with us as Christians. The Hindus discipline, the Muslims discipline, the Jews discipline, but Christians lackadaisical. And that's the truth. No matter where a Muslim man is, he get in and pray. Friday evening, Juma. You understand? Hindus, they get up in the morning and they throw their water ritually. You understand? The Jews, they spend their time 3 times a day praying. We wouldn't even spend 3 minutes. And we want the power of God to flow. And we want to see the manifestation of the presence of God. The Muslims have something they call muktab. That the little boys, they go to the mosque and they learn the Quran to recite it. Not so? You don't know? Yeah. And they go. Discipline. I tell people, close. I'll close on this before I get in trouble. Daily disciplines. Hear it. You have a Christian girl walking down the road and a Muslim girl. More often than not, who is dressed more modestly? And our Bible tells us to dress modestly as women. More often than not. I wonder if you get what I'm saying to us. You have young ladies. You cannot tell them, dress properly. They would short skirt, they would thing, everything plunging, skirt, slit, everything. They have a long skirt, yes, the slit long too. You understand? When they wear the longs, yeah. The same girl picks up a Muslim man, goes and gets into this relationship. Not walking out the road with no short skirt. Hijab. Everything. Even on the beach, they're in their hijab. I wonder if you get what I'm saying. But we who have Christian liberty will not do what God has said in his word. I wonder if you get what I'm saying to us. We are free. But we're not understanding that God wants us to live to a higher standard. And if we allow ourselves to move with the Spirit of God and don't allow our flesh to direct us, and we're exposing all our flesh, we're doing everything, we have to live at a higher standard. And that's why we say we have to give up the laws of the flesh. Give up these things that God has tell us to come out of. He said, come out from among them, be separate. Why does the church want to look like the world? He said, come out. That's what holiness is, when we are sanctified. Come on. Let's live our life based on the word of God. He says, walk after the flesh, walk after the spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lusts of the flesh. The desires of the flesh got to go for the desire of the spirit to rise up. If we kill the flesh, the spirit will come alive. You want to see the spirit of God move in you? Crucify the flesh. Decide now that I am not going to allow my life to be directed by the carnal nature. I want the spirit of God to direct me. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes.